Welcome to the Portland Sustainability Series. My name is Jess Burton, and I am the director of the Southern Maine Conservation Collaborative. We are a nonprofit organization based here in Portland, and our work is to provide direct services, technical and administrative, to conservation organizations, land and water conservation organizations based in York and Cumberland County. We have 19 organizations that we now work with, and the second arm of our mission is to support and facilitate a network between and a conversation between all of these organizations to think about what we can do more together. And part of that work is building strategic partnerships with other efforts and organizations out in the world, because we know that a more woven community is a stronger community. And this is an example of one of our really amazing strategic partnerships with the Portland Public Library. This is the fifth in the series of the sustainability series. We've had a number of really creative and exciting presenters, and it's working for both of our organizations. We also have the Community Television Network here, and they are filming our events and putting them on our webpage and on YouTube so people can watch the events at any other time. Next month we'll be having a presentation called Journey into Climate by a professor from Orono named Paul Majewski. He's a really world-renowned scientist who studies and speaks on the effects of climate change. And then we're scheduling new speakers out for we plan to have this series run for the rest of the year, the fourth Wednesday of every month. And this month, we are thrilled to welcome Revision Energy, and Nick is here. Sorry, so Nick Sampson is a Mainer. He grew up in Maine. On the coast of southern Maine, and he spent a lot of time outdoors with his family all over the state. He is a relationship manager for Revision Energy, and he works with local schools, towns, and other nonprofit organizations to help them save on their energy expenses and carbon emissions through solar energy and advantageous financing partnerships. So I am thrilled to be here to welcome you and introduce you, and now I look forward to your talk.
Thank you.
And thank you all for coming.
Thanks, Jess, for the introduction and for having us here for the sustainability series. And thank you to everyone who joined. So as Jess mentioned, my name is Nick Sampson, and tonight I'll be presenting on solar energy systems and some of the other high efficiency systems that Revision installs. And specifically, I'll be talking about how those can save you money on your energy bills while at the same time reducing your reliance on fossil fuels and your carbon emissions. So just to start, I'll briefly introduce Revision Energy. So we're what's called a turnkey solar energy contracting company, which means that we handle every step of the installation process. Our work is carried out by our in-house teams of engineers, designers, and installers. We were started in 2003 up in Liberty, Maine. Here's a little map of our shops. We opened up in Portland in 2006, and as you can see, we now operate a total of five shops. Since 2003, we've installed more than 5,000 systems. We're quickly approaching 6,000 in northern New England, which we're really excited about. Something else, just to go back briefly, that we were also very excited about, as of 2015, we earned a B Corp or Benefit Corporation certification. Basically, this is a certification awarded to businesses that proactively focus on positive social and environmental change. A couple recognizable B Corps include Patagonia and Ben & Jerry's. And so we are a mission-driven company, and our mission is to accelerate the transition away from a fossil fuel-based economy to a clean energy economy in northern New England. And so just to touch on briefly, Maine has the highest per capita fossil fuel consumption as well as carbon emissions. We export $5 billion annually to import fossil fuels. We use roughly 1.5 billion gallons of fuel just for transportation and heating in the state. And as many of you may have heard, roughly almost exactly a week ago, NASA and NOAA announced that 2016 was the hottest year on record. So the last 17 of the hottest years on record have occurred since 2000, or 16 of those 17 years have occurred since 2000. So while temperatures are rising, one thing that's very exciting for the solar industry is the cost of solar energy has been decreasing. So over the past 10 years, the cost of solar has dropped by more than 75%. And this has led to a significant increase in its popularity, which we find very exciting. Just to give you an idea of the solar resource that's available to the world, this picture shows in the yellow circle the annual solar energy resource that's available globally. Coal and gas, the two circles representing coal and gas, are for their total energy resource that's available. So while it's great that the cost of solar has come down so much and there's such a great resource of it available globally, a lot of people still, especially during this time of the year, during the winter, still wonder if solar is a viable energy source here in Maine and northern New England. So we might not receive the sunlight that the French Riviera does, but we're actually on the same latitude as a lot of areas on the Mediterranean. We receive more solar energy than Germany does. Germany is located underneath that French Riviera tag. We receive roughly 33% more sunlight than Germany does on an annual basis. And why that's important is because Germany's been leading the world in solar energy systems installed per capita to date. So we see that as a great example of what a good resource we have here in the area. Just to quickly note, I mentioned Germany last year. They achieved or supplied nearly 100% of the whole country's power demand. My understanding is it was a summer day, and it was pretty windy in the north part where there are a lot of wind turbines, and pretty sunny in the southern part of the country. And so one final thing to show in regards to the solar resource that we have available to us in northern New England is the study that the National Renewable Energy Laboratory recently came out with. So they looked at each state's total electricity consumption and how much of that electricity consumption could be offset with just rooftop solar. The dark states represent a high score, so a high portion of each state's electricity consumption could be offset with rooftop solar. The lighter scored a little lower on the scale. As you can see, Maine and northern New England scored very well, with Maine, with the report finding that Maine could offset more than 55% of our total electricity consumption with just rooftop solar. So if a homeowner is interested in looking into a solar energy system with Revision Energy, the first step involves usually an initial evaluation of that site. And usually it's just on Google Earth software, so it's usually very, very quick and simple. We take a look at a homeowner's address, and what we're looking for is, this is a street actually located in Brunswick. What we're usually looking for is some of the homes. You can see those sunny rooftops there that are located on the northern part of the street. So they have good solar exposure, good orientation. If you look closely, you can actually see that a couple of these homes have solar energy systems on them already. A couple of them, and one further down the street. And so those rooftops are great for solar, and that's what we're looking for when we look on Google Earth. If we see a roof, you know, that has kind of that red tree, I don't know if you can notice this red tree right here, right in front, that might not be as good for an on-site solar application. But usually we'll just try to get a general look before coming out to the house, so we have an understanding of what the roof looks like and what the potential is before we're on site. And so once we're on site, we'll do a couple of things for the what we call the site visit. So we'll first look at a homeowner's electric bill, and we'll basically total the electric bill to see over the past 12 months to see how much the homeowner is using for electricity annually. When we design a system, we'll try to offset the majority of that electricity consumption without exceeding it. We will also look using the electric bill at what you're spending on your electricity, and that gives us an idea of what the savings opportunity is and what the payback period is for a system. The other thing that we'll do during a site visit is we'll evaluate the site basically. We'll look at your electrical system and your rooftop. And when we look at the rooftop, we're measuring it, but we're also doing a shading analysis on the roof. And that is included, a picture of that shading analysis is included at the top of this slide here. Basically, what we do is we take, with a fisheye lens, we take a picture of the horizon from the perspective of your roof, and that the software that we have tracks out the path of the sun over the time of the day and the time of the year. So I don't know if everybody can see it, but basically the x-axis is time of the day and y-axis is time of the year. Yellow represents when you'll have sun on your roof or on your array, and green represents when it might be in the shade because of, it looks like a few trees up there. So this gives us a solar resource value or a solar exposure value, and we use that to put a generation estimate together for your system. So that helps us really fine tune our proposal and get an idea of really what type of system you can have on your roof. So once a homeowner or a business owner installs solar, the system, it obviously involves the solar panels that go up on the rooftop, or as I'll show a little later on, could be a ground mount application. But so you have the solar panels, and then the other major system component is the inverter system. And basically how this system works is when the sun's shining, the array is producing direct current electricity, and that direct current electricity is fed down into what's called the inverter system, or the inverter. The inverter converts that DC electricity to alternating current electricity, or AC electricity. That's then compatible with the home and with the grid. And so when the sun's shining, it's first going to feed electricity into your home. It's going to feed on-site demand. If generation exceeds on-site demand, you're going to send the additional electricity that you're producing out to the grid. And through a program that's called net metering, which I'll explain in the next slide, you're basically building up credits with the utility. So you get a kilowatt hour credit for every solar kilowatt hour that you send out to the grid. So then during times of the year when you're using more electricity than you're producing, those credits are going to go towards basically buying down or offsetting your bill. So just to briefly cover the economics of a residential solar energy system, a standard system installation might cost anywhere from $10,000 to $30,000. I know that's a wide range, but it depends on what you're using for electricity and what your roof space looks like, how much space you have available for a system. Currently, there's a 30% federal tax credit that's available for solar energy systems. So that's a dollar-for-dollar reduction in your tax liability the year that you have that system installed. And through the net metering program that I just mentioned, you receive full retail value for all solar electricity that you send out to the grid, so all solar electricity that you produce. And generally, we find that a residential system here in Maine is going to have a payback period of anywhere from 8 to 15 years, just depending on the cost that you're paying for electricity, the orientation of the roof, production of the system, all of those variables. So feel free to ask questions as I go. So a couple of things that make solar so cost effective is how long the panels will last, as well as how simple the systems are. So the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, the same laboratory that collected that study on the potential for rooftop solar in each state, collected studies on existing systems that were installed in the 1970s and 1980s many of which were over in Europe, some of which were in the local New England area. But what they found is that those systems are still effectively producing 70 to 80% of their maximum power output currently. And I just read about a school actually in Massachusetts that I believe is 30 years old, and it's still producing 90% of its expected power output 30 years after it was installed. So they have, the panels have a lifetime expectancy of 40 years, which is great. And because the systems are so simple, there's really low, if any, operating and maintenance costs. So there's no moving parts and very simple systems, very, very easy to maintain. So essentially what you're doing when you're investing in a solar energy system is you're locking in a supply of electricity for roughly 40 years or for the lifetime of that system, however long you have it around. And this allows you to do that at a very low cost per kilowatt hour. So if you were to take the all-in cost of that system or however much it costs to buy that system, and divide that by how much electricity it generates over its lifespan, it results in a really low cost per kilowatt hour. Usually it's roughly, for residential systems, anywhere from 9 to maybe 11 cents a kilowatt hour, and the current rate is 13 cents a kilowatt hour. For businesses, there are some additional tax incentives that are available, so that could be even lower, at anywhere from maybe 6 to 8 cents a kilowatt hour. So not only are you locking in that supply of electricity for a low cost per kilowatt hour, but you are protecting yourself against the variability of utility rates in the future. The Energy Information Administration performs an annual energy outlook, and their past couple of annual outlooks have found that they expect energy rates to increase by roughly 2.5% a year on average over the next 20 years, just to give you an idea. So one final benefit of solar is that it actually, studies have shown that it will add value to your home and actually speed up the payback, or speed up the sale of the home. So this is a study that came out of Berkeley, California, and a few other studies have been done like this before 2015, but when this came out in 2015, it was fairly significant because it looked at several states across the US rather than just individual states. And most of them had focused on California. But what this found is that on average, a solar energy system is gonna increase the resale value of a home by roughly $15,000. If you look at the installation cost to put the system up, versus the increase in the resale value, it usually comes out the same, if not the resale value is a little bit higher than what that installation, or the difference in resale value is a little higher than what that installation cost was, which we find very encouraging. Yeah?
Might be getting to this, but what's the wind rating for rooftop insulation?
Yeah, great question. So when we install a system, we're installing it to meet the wind load of the area. So in Portland, it might be 90 miles an hour. If we're up on a hill somewhere that's windier, it might be 100 to 110 miles an hour possibly. So we'll design the system to meet that wind load, that peak wind load. We'll do the same for snow load as well.
So I assume, like in that picture, ideally you have a south-facing roof, but say that roof was facing southwest, would you angle those panel sets to...
That's a great question. So actually, I might hop back a few slides here. So when solar costs were up here, we probably would, if you had a western orientation, we probably would have pitched the panels. We would have put them on a racking system to orient them more due south and give them optimal pitch. So say you have a low pitch roof, you know, you might increase the pitch of that to 35 degrees, which is optimal in Maine and New Hampshire. But since the cost of solar panels have come down so much, so now that we're down here, actually the cost to add a few panels to make up for the loss of production or the lower production that you have on a west-facing roof or a shallow pitch roof is less than the cost of adding that racking system to the array. So we're actually finding that we'll install systems on east and west facing roofs that are really shallow pitch, and those are still very cost effective systems. So those, whether it's a business or a homeowner or an institution that installs those, they receive solar energy in the morning when it's on the east facing roof, and good production in the afternoon and evening when it's hitting that west facing roof. That's a great question. Yeah.
Can you speak a little bit about roofing materials and replacing the roof, and what that entails on the solar panel side of things?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. So let's get back to this picture here. So this is an installation on an asphalt roof. That's what we do most commonly. But we'll really install on any type of roof. Slate might be one of the exceptions. I think we've done one slate roof before, but it was pretty complicated and costly. But we'll install a lot on asphalt roofs, and they generally have an expected lifespan of 25 years. So if they have less than half of their expected lifespan left, we will generally recommend that the homeowner or business owner replace that roof before they install a system. If you get to a point where you're 20 years into a system and the roof needs to be replaced, you would have a solar contractor come out to the home, remove the array, have the roof replaced, and then put the array back up on the roof. What's really common to do if you're replacing your roof and installing solar, or building new construction and installing solar, is to do standing seam metal. So that has a longer lifespan of maybe 50 or more, or 50 to 60 years. So usually if you throw solar on that, you're pretty much set. So standing seam will attach actually right to the standing seams. We'll attach those seams. We have seam clamps basically that attach right on, and it minimizes the roof penetrations for those systems. Good question.
Yes. When is it advantageous not to have the array on the roof, say if you have an open field next to your house? Or?
Yeah, great question. So let's see. So if you're, I might be able to find one on this Google Earth image, but if you're, if you have a lot of shade on the roof, or you have, say you don't have the, you might not have the space on the roof. So if you have a lot of small dormers, like window dormers, or a lot of piping on the roof that breaks up the roof and makes it hard for the installation, but you have good ground space, it could be a great application for a ground mounted system. And it all depends on what your goals are as a homeowner or business owner. So if you don't want to use your roof space, then a ground mount would be a great application. If you only want it on the roof and you don't want to use up your ground space, then certainly try to make the roof work. So that's part of the site evaluation process as well, as trying to just get an understanding of what the goals are for the system. And actually, so that's perfect timing. So I'll just go through just a few examples of some of the systems that we'll install. So this is just a rooftop system. This is in Portland, Maine, and we can actually orient the panels a couple of different ways, two different ways, but this is what's called landscape. So you can see that they're horizontal on the roof. And basically whoever did that site evaluation found that that was the best fit for that roof. So we could maximize that roof space with panels in landscape. This is an example of a ground mount system. This was up the coast, I believe. And so probably didn't have a great rooftop or but great field space. And so they had this system installed nice and close to their home, which always is helpful for the installation cost. So it means a shorter power run to the home and helps keep the cost of the installation down. This is another ground mount system, just to give you an example. And this is a dual axis tracker that we'll sometimes install. So this system tracks the sun on both axes throughout the day, basically. So it's maximizing solar production. So we find that in this area, depending on the solar exposure of a site, this system could increase production by 20 to 30% of standard production, basically. And, you know, ideal applications for this system are maybe less ground space, but not a good roof space. There, we install All Earth trackers. They're called All Sun trackers, manufactured by All Earth, based out of Vermont. So these are certainly built for this northern New England climate. These systems will actually, when the snow is falling, they'll tilt to the north and track to the north at night to dump the snow off to the north side, so it builds up out away from its track during the day. They'll also lay flat if the wind exceeds 30 to 35 miles an hour, basically to reduce wear and tear on the system. And I believe these are rated for 120 mile an hour winds. So pretty cool systems. So if you don't have a great rooftop site, or you don't have a great ground site, homeowners and business owners can actually now still invest in solar off-site. So we, Revision Energy, in 2015 started working with community solar farms, and basically what these involve is a homeowner or business owner buying a certain number of panels at this ground-mounted system, and basically you build up a credit when the sun's shining on your electric bill, depending on how much electricity your panels are producing throughout the day. So in a community solar farm, you can have up to 9 members in Maine, and it's just like a solar array on your home, where you own the panels, you own the portion of the system components of that array that you bought, and it goes to offsetting your bill. So we're pretty excited to be able to offer solar to really anyone that is interested in investing in it. Yeah.
Where are there examples of that?
Yeah, great question. So this one is, this is an in-progress photo of one that we just installed at Crystal Springs Farm in Brunswick, Maine. This one, so as you can see, this one can be seen right from the road. We installed, one of our first ones was installed at the Maine Idle Motor Court in Freeport. So if you're headed up to Brunswick and between exit 24 and exit 28, if you look to your right there as you're headed north, there's a solar array in that field across the way there. So that's a community solar farm over there. We've installed another in Wayne, I believe one in Wiscasset, and I know we're at 6 or 7 now, so there are a couple more that I'm forgetting. So as I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, a lot of Maine's fossil fuel consumption can be attributed to heating and transportation. So Revision Energy installs hyper-efficient air source heat pumps, and we believe that by pairing the solar with these air source heat pumps, which heat and cool homes, you have the opportunity to basically go after your fossil fuel consumption instead of, or in addition to, offsetting just the plug load of your home or appliances of your home. So air source heat pumps, have you all seen air source heat pumps before? Seen like outdoor units and maybe an indoor unit? So basically the outdoor unit is what's called a compressor. In this picture, it's located right here on the outside of the home. And that runs a refrigerant line set to the indoor unit, which is located inside the home. And basically, the way these systems work is just like your refrigerator, but in reverse during the winter season. So they have, as I mentioned, a refrigerant that collects latent heat, even at low temperatures during the winter time. And they transfer that heat from the outside of your home into your indoor unit, which then distributes throughout maybe a space of 1,000 square feet, 1,500 square feet, depending on the size of the unit. And so since they're transferring heat versus creating it with electricity, they're incredibly efficient. Air source heat pumps are about 2.5 to 3 times as efficient as standard heating methods. And so because they are that efficient, they're using less electricity, and therefore it's easier to offset that electricity with solar. So it's a great way to offset your fossil fuel consumption or your oil consumption with solar energy. Anybody have questions about, yeah?
The indoor unit, do you recommend, the ones I've seen have been all mounted pretty high on the wall.
Yeah.
Is that recommended? I mean, ideally in our house we'd mount it low, but no.
So we actually have, we have a couple of options. Just based on the specs, the more efficient option is typically going to be the wall mounted unit that goes up higher. Generally, depending on the layout of the space, it also might do a better job of distributing that heat. However, we're installing more and more of the floor mounted units, so that's certainly an option as well. And they're, they have the same ratings. There are several different options for what they can produce for BTUs per hour. So floor mounted is certainly a great option.
What's the recommended run between the exterior and interior, or is it that? The run between the exterior unit and the interior unit, is it?
Yes, so shorter is certainly better. It depends on the unit. So there, you could do what are called mini splits, where you do one-to-one units. So you have one outdoor unit to one indoor unit. And I think once you exceed 25 feet or 30 feet, you start to lose some of the efficiency, I believe. And then you have multi-splits, which you could have one outdoor unit to up to four, I'll say. Maybe there might be some that can go up to eight. I think up to eight off of one outdoor unit. And those, I believe, have a little longer. It can go a little longer distance. Generally, you can go pretty far. If you can do a shorter line set, that's great. But usually we're not in a situation where we can't access a room from a certain outdoor location with residential applications. So it can certainly do it. I think it goes, it can go up to 100 feet or so. So I'd have to look at the specs to tell you exactly, but.
So that unit's basically taking outdoor air and putting it inside, creating a positive pressure in the house?
That's a great question as well. I don't believe that there's any problems with pressure. It's taking heat from outside. It's not taking air from outside. So basically all that it's doing is it's circulating air in the home. And it's filtering that air as it's circulating it, but it's basically transferring heat through that refrigerant, which is a closed loop system. So, great question. Yeah.
Do you guys do any underground, like deep geo type product?
We don't. So we stick with the air source heat pumps. Not that geo isn't a good source of heat. Heat pumps are roughly 300% efficient, whereas geothermal is, my understanding, is like 400% efficient, but just requires, I think, a different skill set and a little bit more intensive for the insulation practice. So, yeah. But we find that air source heat pumps are, my understanding is geothermal can be great for really large homes. You're trying to basically heat a big space and where you would otherwise have really high oil bills. Air source heat pumps are great for retrofits. So if you just want to reduce your oil consumption and keep that say you have an oil system, that boiler in place, you can, install one heat pump for, say, maybe anywhere from maybe, say, $4,000, $4,500. And you can install it in a place that you use most often in the home for basically the greatest savings opportunity. And you can get most of your heat from that system. They're also great for smaller homes as well.
Yeah. So I have a home on Peaks Island. Yeah. It's not a heat pump.
Very nice.
But I mostly live in Brooklyn. And so I experimented a little bit. I was turning the heat pump off and having my oil thermostat set to 50,
yeah.
But the last time I left, I set my oil at 48 and set my heat pump at that minimum heat setting.
Yeah.
And that I have a neighbor who comes by pretty regularly to check on the house, and she said that the inside temperature was pretty much always like 60.
Oh, interesting.
And so, but in any case, I guess my most important question is it okay to just leave the heat pump running all the time when we're down in Brooklyn and just leave the oil set below just as kind of backup? Is that a good strategy?
Absolutely, yeah. That's actually the perfect way to do it, no matter how you're using the home. So heat pumps run most efficiently when you just set the temperature and forget it. So a lot of people like to turn your oil down or your thermostat down at night and then back up in the morning. But heat pumps actually are extremely efficient because they are good at basically maintaining that temperature and using very little energy while they maintain that set temperature. If you turn them down and then ramp them back up, they're going to be less efficient. So studies have shown that that's the best way to use them, is just set the temperature and let it be. That's exactly how we recommend to do it. If you're basically, heat pumps will work down to the Mitsubishis that we install are guaranteed to work down to minus 13 degrees Fahrenheit. They maintain 100% of their rated heating capacity down to 5 degrees Fahrenheit. But if you get to some really cold temperatures below, minus 13 degrees, they might turn off to protect the system. So that's exactly what we recommend, is set the temperature and then have your backup heat source on, set a few degrees below what the heat pump set temperature is. So that's a great way to do it. Have you been able to look at your bills since setting it that way to see how it's working?
It's just been for like 2 weeks or something, so we'll check the bill and compare it to last year.
Yeah.
So I have another question, which is, because we're not up here very much, our current electric bills are not going to reflect what it'll be like when we do move up here full time. So
yeah.
I anticipate that if we're using heat pump as our primary source for heat and possibly installing another unit, because make sure the whole house gets heated, and we're up here all the time, I guess we have a southern basic roof, so I can talk to you individually, but it's just, can you do an assessment even though our bills will not show what it'll be like because we don't live here?
Yeah, absolutely. So with heat pumps specifically, we can look at what the general insulation value is of the home, what the envelope looks like, what amount of space it will be heating, and we can basically calculate, we can come up with an estimate for what those systems will be using for electricity annually. In addition to that, if we're working with a new construction project for a homeowner or somebody's moving into a new home, a lot of times we'll look at the existing electric bill at the home that they're moving out of, and we'll try to make adjustments based on what appliances are in the existing home and what ones will be in the new home. So something we can certainly work on. So absolutely. That's a great question. Yeah.
How many, on average, panels would you need to run a mini split?
Oh, great question. It depends on what type of mini split, but I could generally say probably, I would say anywhere from maybe 8 to 10 panels would be my, maybe 6 to 10.
Yeah.
Sorry for widening that range on you, but any we generally find that a mini split might, it depends on a lot of things like what the production is of the array, where it's installed, what the habits are for heating in the home, but and what you're setting the temperature to, what time of the year it is. But generally, the heat pumps might use anywhere from maybe 2,000 to 4,000 kilowatt hours a year, really, really roughly. Anywhere from 6 to 10 panels or so would be able to cover the majority of that. So, great question.
Another question.
Yeah.
Those dual axis in ground rotating things.
Yeah, drivers.
What is the differential cost on that installation versus the roof?
Yeah, so generally, if you have the right application for it, generally the increased production could offset the additional, the higher costs of that system. Because it is a more complex system, or there are some moving parts, it does have a higher install cost, as you guess. So it could be, you know, just roughly that system, a tracker system could be roughly anywhere from, I'd say, $32,000 to $40,000. There are a couple of different options, but you could have a 20-panel tracker or a 24-panel tracker, and then you have different options on what you're throwing on it for panels. So you could throw standard efficiency panels on it, or you could put high efficiency panels on it, which would affect the cost of the system. But maybe $32,000 to $40,000.
How high up the ground cable can the panels be?
So we will install. We'll install the panels to meet the snow load of the area. So usually it's going to be 3 feet off the ground. Yeah.
Speaking of snow, how do you deal with the solar panels with the snow on the roof? Like, we have a situation where we roof rake on occasion.
Yeah. So we recommend just letting the snow be on the panels and letting it slide. Actually, it's a really common question, especially after, I think, 2002 winters ago, whenever we had all that snow. So usually what we recommend is just let the panels be, let them shed the snow naturally. So the panels are made of tempered glass. They're going to shed snow similarly to a metal roof versus an asphalt roof. So what I've heard is that they might go a little slower than a metal roof. So if you have a high enough pitch, so say anywhere from 32 degrees to 45 degrees, it's probably going to shed that snow fairly routinely. If it's a shallower pitch roof, we still would recommend just leaving it. If you want to be proactive about it, I've heard of people putting basically something that's protective on that roof rake to basically make sure they're not going to damage the panels. And you can either rake the bottom of the panels, or sometimes you can just roof rake the snow that builds up on the roof space below the bottom of the panel and the drip edge of the roof, just to clear that out so that the snow can shed. What we do when we put together our performance estimate for each system is we factor in, our engineers are looking at data from existing systems on how the generation is affected by snow in the wintertime. So we factor in some loss of production due to snow based on your array's pitch and orientation. So, great question. So this is another appliance that we will install. It's a heat pump water heater. So this uses the same technology as an air source heat pump, but basically it's that compressor, which is outside for the air source heat pump, is inside and on top of the tank for the heat pump water heater. You can actually, if you can see that grate on the top of that tank there, that's the compressor. And so basically, we like to install this type of system in a nice large basement space. If you have 1,000 square feet or more in a basement that stays relatively warm, it can be a really great application. So this system transfers heat from that basement into the tank and uses that heat to heat up the water in the tank. In doing so, it uses about a third of the electricity of a standard electric tank. Additionally, this is a nice benefit. It dehumidifies the basement as well, so that can be nice in the summertime if things are getting fairly humid down in the basement space. So these also, just like air source heat pumps, because they're using less electricity and so are so efficient, are easier to offset with solar. So you can not only use solar for the energy required to heat your home, but you can use solar for the energy required to heat your water. So this is a new construction home. Oh, sorry.
So what's the size of the tank typically in terms of volume of water?
Yeah, great question. So we install two options for, this is the Stiebel Eltron heat pump water heater. We install a 58-gallon Stiebel Eltron and we Accelera, and then we install an 80-gallon Stiebel Eltron Accelera. So.
Yeah.
Do you think that that would be installed in the basement in a raised format, like say 4 feet off the basement floor?
So the tank, have the tank sit 4 feet off the basement floor? That is something I would ask one of our master plumbers. I'm not entirely sure. I know that sometimes we'll elevate it maybe 6 inches with like, I think we have a platform that we will put underneath it. I don't know if we've ever done 4 feet.
How would it handle flooding in the basement?
That's also a great question that I would have to double check on. We probably ideally wouldn't be putting it somewhere where that floods often. But so we would look at options for, like you mentioned, trying to elevate it if we need to. What's the height of the basement, if you don't mind me asking? 8 feet. Yeah, so it depends on the size of the tank too. So if you're these tanks are fairly tall and require a little bit of space in between the top and the top of the ceiling just to circulate air. So might be a little challenging to mount at 4 feet off the ground, but something we could certainly discuss and look at and talk to you about how often it floods and try to.
Only during the 100-year storms.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure we'd be fine with that. yeah, that's true. That'd be something we would just look at and probably talk to maybe a master, one of our master plumbers or thermal operations manager. So this is a new construction home that was built in Jackson, New Hampshire. And as you can see, it has a nice 24-panel solar array on top. And it also heats the home entirely with one air source heat pump and has an electric water heater. So this home is offsetting 100% of not only its electricity consumption, but its entire energy consumption with just solar. And so that's achieved through, as I mentioned, those really efficient appliances that are heating the home and as well as the water, but also a really tight envelope, a really well-insulated building. I find this really encouraging for Northern New England, just because of the climate that we have, that you can fully power your home with an array on your rooftop. This is also corrugated metal, if anybody's interested in roofing material, but this is a corrugated metal system. Yeah.
Do you ever mount these arrays on top of SIP panels? Or is there any factor there that comes into play?
We, on top of SIP panels, with roofing material on top of the SIP panels? That's a good question. I'd have to look into that. We do have options for if it's a really difficult, if it's a different roof structure, we do have options. We have feet that attach to most of those roof structures. It just might make the installation a little more complicated, but certainly something we can look into. So.
Yeah.
So how many additional panels, I mean, I know it would vary, but would you have to add to have a complete system like this with heat pumps and a hot water tank?
Yeah, good question. This is a roughly seven kilowatt system. I looked at their electric bill. I'd say maybe add 3 or 4 kilowatts to do the heating and cooling and hot water of the home. That's a really rough estimate. I think they had actually figured out exactly what they would need before we got out there for the site visit. But it depends on the space of the home. But yeah, I'd say you could, this has one heat pump and electric hot water, I'd say 3 to 4 kilowatts, which is basically the panels that we install can be anywhere from 280 watts to 320 watts right now. So a 3 kilowatt system or 3.2 kilowatt system would be 10 of our high efficiency panels. And a 3.6 kilowatt system would be, sorry, not a 3.6, I was thinking 5.6. But a 2.8 kilowatt system would be 10 of our standard efficiency panels, just to give you an idea. So not only are people in Maine and New Hampshire pairing solar with hot water appliances and heating and cooling appliances, but they're starting to pair them with their electric vehicles. So which is very exciting. And so electric vehicles offer driving for really, really cost effectively for roughly 4 cents per mile versus 15 cents per mile with a traditional gas-powered sedan, basically. So we find that, you know, generally 9 solar panels with kind of standard installation can power basically a Nissan Leaf to drive about 10,000 miles each year. So 9 solar panels for 10,000 miles. A common electric vehicle charging station that you can install for your home would be a level 2 charging station, which can power most electric vehicles like a Nissan Leaf in fully power in about 8 hours or so. And those might cost anywhere from $1,500 to $2,000 for an electric vehicle charging station. Any questions on that?
Yeah. How about, say you would be charging mostly at night, how does that work?
Yeah, so basically in that situation you've built up credits during the daytime with your solar array, and when you're using the electricity during the nighttime to power the electric vehicle, those credits are then being applied to your bill. So there's some really exciting technology that I don't know enough about, but I've heard a little bit about is called vehicle to home. Basically cars and charging stations where you can take the stored electricity that you have in your electric vehicle that you supplied with solar, and you can use that to run your home at night, basically. So you can take advantage of when the sun's shining, you can power you can charge up your car, and then if you haven't used up all the charge in your car while you've been driving around, you can then send that solar electricity back to the home from your vehicle. That's still, I believe, a little ways out, but certainly encouraging to see the type of technology that's out there. This is an installation we recently did at the University of New England. This is at their bus stop, but as you can see, 9 panels there, and we have 2 on both sides of those windows there. We have 2 Clipper Creek level 2 EV charging stations. And so I'm just gonna take you through a few of the systems that we've installed in the last couple of years. This was installed in Hiram, Maine. This is an 80 kilowatt ground mount system. Have you all heard of Grandiote? They do granola, homemade granola, oatmeal, a Maine-based company, and they moved into a new facility in 2015. And at that new facility, they installed this 80 kilowatt solar array, a ground-mounted system, which was designed to offset, I believe, 100% of their electricity consumption. This system was also installed in 2015. This is a ground-mounted system that was installed on, it's the first solar array to be installed on a capped landfill in Maine. Massachusetts is I believe leading the way for installing solar on capped landfills, but we're really excited about this opportunity to basically develop unusable landfills and brownfields with clean renewable energy. Just to point out, if anybody's curious about what these big blocks are down here, so the capped landfill we can't penetrate into that capped landfill, obviously. So a standard ground mount, we would drive piles, or what are called ground screws, maybe 7 feet into the ground to create that, basically that structure that holds the ground mount in place. Since we can't do that with a landfill, we install these ballasts, which could be anywhere from 4,500 to 6,000 pounds each to hold that ground mount in place. This is, as you can see, the Friends School of Portland, which is in Falmouth, Maine, actually. And this school, so schools generally use a lot of electricity. They're one of the highest users of electricity. This school was built in 2015. It's a very efficient envelope, and they basically rely on those hyper-efficient air source heat pump systems to heat and cool the building. And so with this, after the first year of operation of the solar array, they determined that they are offsetting 60% of the school's entire energy consumption with this solar array. This system was installed in 2016 at a high school in New Hampshire. It is, I believe, the first school in New Hampshire to offset 100% of its electricity usage, or near 100%, with solar on-site solar electricity. This photo, I think, gives a good example of how we have the ability to install on a hillside, and we can install on a pitch that goes north-south as well as east and west, as you can see there. This was the largest ground mount that we've done in Maine so far, and it is located in Westbrook. It was installed for Wish Camper, which is a housing authority based out of Maine. And so we installed this in 2016. This is the largest rooftop system we've done to date, and this is, as you can see, 266 kilowatts up at Hebron Academy. This array includes almost 1,000 solar panels. I think it's 970 solar panels. So just for a little encouragement, there are some fun slides at the end here. So this, I believe they're calling this actually a net positive car. So as you can see with the solar panels on the back of the car, and it's really efficient design. It's electric, but it basically collects all the power that it needs to run with those solar panels on the back. So net neutral car, or net positive, if maybe you look into it a little bit more. And this is the world's first solar powered plane to fly across the planet. My understanding is that this project was put together to show an example of really the potential of solar energy for the world and the future. And so one final thing that I wanted to touch on is that I recently came across a study by the Brookings Institute which basically disproved what's kind of been a common belief, that if you decarbonize, you're going to be hindering economic growth or the economy. And this Brookings Institute study found that, in fact, by decarbonizing, a lot of states have improved their economy. They've continued with great economic growth, and in many situations have actually accelerated their economic growth. So since solar energy systems are scalable, we think it gives homeowners, business owners, and institutions a great opportunity to take advantage or take control of their energy supply, their energy bills, supporting a clean energy future, and also supporting a growing forward thinking, forward moving economy. So thank you very much for letting me chat about it here tonight. And happy to take questions. So
yeah, I'm currently building a new house, and my budget's currently being exceeded pretty quickly here. But I'd like to, one question, rub in or rub out, you know, the necessary components I need to install solar panels.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I'm at the point where I want to get, you know, put heat pumps in, obviously, you know.
But nice. That's great.
I want to look ahead and rub in anything I have to rub in for future solar panels.
Yeah, so we would be more than happy to come rough in that work. We generally, if we're going to rough in work, I know that revision ourselves, we like to do it if you're comfortable with that, just because we know, we think it's more efficient, more cost effective, and can do it. We can also basically give you advice on you know what we would recommend for the rough in.
So heat pumps are a good price to do that. I already got a price for heat pumps and two units
are
split.
Yep. Yeah.
Just soon, if we could work this in for future solar, that'd be awesome.
Oh, great. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so we can certainly do a quote for heat pumps as well, and c- can give you, if you contact our shop, we can give you an idea of, you know, what the, that rough-in cost might be and what it would involve, basically. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Does Revision get into advocacy at all for state and their solar bills?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, we do. I don't know as much about it, so I probably won't be able to answer. But yeah, Brittany would certainly be the one to talk to you about that. So,
Is it practical to have a system where you're storing your extra electricity on site as opposed to the net metering concept that you discussed earlier?
Absolutely. Yeah. So we've started to work with lithium ion batteries as backup systems. We installed this past year in the area, I think we installed two or three lithium ion batteries. These were Sonnen batteries, which come over from Germany, but they're lithium ion technology. And basically these battery systems can function two ways. They can just function as backup for the home if the power goes out. They can also cycle nightly. So if you're interested, you place an added value on using your solar electricity at night versus electricity from the grid. You can cycle the batteries nightly. So generally, they're going to feed a distributed load panel. So basically any essential loads that you select. I don't know if, I imagine many of you are familiar with Tesla, but following Tesla's announcement about the Powerwall, there has been a lot of interest in the battery industry, and people expect it to follow a similar path to what solar's done over the last 10 years, in the next coming 10 years. And I think 2017 is actually supposed to be a pretty significant year for lithium ion technology. So, which is exciting. One thing I meant to mention about the solar energy electric systems is they will shut down when the power goes out. So they basically, that's for code purposes. So they aren't risking anybody's safety that's working on the power lines. Yeah.
So net metering is in trouble, right? Politically speaking, it may go away or something.
Yeah. Yeah, so the main, basically what happened, so net metering, just to go back, is the one-to-one credit that a solar energy customer receives when they send a kilowatt hour of solar out to the grid. They export it to the grid. You receive that one-to-one kilowatt hour credit. And so last August, CMP's territory, basically 1% of their peak demand on the grid was supplied by solar. So that triggered a review by the Maine Public Utilities Commission for net metering. Basically, it triggered a net metering review. So the PUC has looked at net metering, and they put out and whether or not net metering should stick around, whether or not they should reduce the credit value that solar customers receive for electricity sent out to the grid. And last fall, early winter, they put out a proposal that would slightly reduce that kilowatt hour credit for solar electricity sent out to the grid. So you have basically, really generally, it would reduce, if you install a system in 2017, it would reduce that kilowatt hour credit by 5%, basically. If you install it in 2018, it would reduce that credit value by 10%. And so it's a reduction in credit value for 10 years, basically. But once you install that system, you lock in the credit value for 15 years, basically. So to dive into it a little more deeply, so you have two sections of your electric bill, your CMP bill. When you go home and look at your CMP bill, one is for transmission and delivery, so that's the CMP side, and then one's for supply. Current utility rates for residential average at about 13 cents a kilowatt hour. It's about half of that for the T&D portion of the bill, the CMP portion. So 6.5 cents and about half that for the supply. So about 6.5 cents per kilowatt hour. And so what the PUC has proposed is basically a 90% credit value for the T&D portion of the bill if you install a system in 2017, and the supply credit remains the same at a one-to-one credit. And then it's a declining by 10% credit value, so 80% in 2018, 70% in 2019, and so on. So that's the proposal, and they are currently, they've received feedback and comments on that, and they're now reviewing that feedback and will be making a decision on their on whether they're going to adjust net metering or not, and what that change would be sometime between, most likely between February and this summer. So one thing, basically what we're finding when we do a savings projection is that that change does not have a really significant impact on the payback period of the system, and it's still very cost effective to do over the lifetime of the project. One thing to point out is that the Maine PUC did have a study done by a third party on the value of solar energy here in the state a couple of years ago, and basically that study found that solar actually benefits the grid. It adds value to the grid because solar or distributed generation or solar generation is produced close to where it's being used. So it reduces line loss. It prevents the need for transmission upgrades to get more power out to those sites. And it's also producing power at times of the year when there's real, or times of the day and year when there's really high demand on the grid. So those sunny, hot days when a lot of people are using their AC. Solar is feeding a lot of electricity back into the grid and helping reduce the amount of electricity that what they call ancillary power plants have to provide, which are costly and dirty to come online and feed power into the grid. So the study found that solar is actually is more valuable than the current retail rate of electricity. And so this proposed rule change ignores that study, basically. The Massachusetts, the equivalent of their PUC, recently had a similar review process, and they found that their determination was that the utility did not provide enough data to show that that solar doesn't deserve, or basically solar does what's called a cost shift, and they therefore didn't see a need or it necessary to adjust net metering or their solar rules, basically.
Yeah.
How long will the federal credit be available with current legislation?
That's tough to say. So it's right now the 30% federal tax credit is available. It was extended through 2019. Yep. So if it isn't changed, if you install a system in 2019, you can take advantage of that 30% federal tax credit. For residential customers, if you install, it's a drop down after 2019. So if you install in 2020, it drops down to a 26% credit. And then if you install in 2021, it's a 22% credit. And then it goes away after 2021. So that's as it stands right now. Yeah.
What about off the grid?
Yeah, so 99% of the systems that we install currently are grid-tied systems, but we certainly will look at off-grid applications. A lot of times it can make sense if you're building a new home, or you already have you don't have any power at your home, but you want to add power to the home. But the cost of extending that utility line to your home exceeds the cost of a battery backup system, or is in the range of the cost of that battery backup system, then it can be a really good application. Also, if you just place an added value on being off-grid, then that certainly could be a great project for the home. Usually, we will try to make sure that the solar installation is going to be maximizing production in the summertime and wintertime, so not just on an annual basis, but during both seasons, which means that usually we'll install it at a steeper pitch than we would on just a regular grid tied application. So we're ideally you'd have like a 45 degree or a 12 pitch.
Yeah.
So in a house that is currently traditionally electrified with a Mera, for example, the interior electrical wiring it remains intact, is that correct? There's no alterations to that system?
Exactly right. So unless you need an upgrade, which is really uncommon, unless it's a really old fuse box or a very old, unsafe electric panel, we would leave everything in place as it is, and we would just interconnect the solar array through what's called a back feed breaker. So we could throw a breaker into your electric panel, and that's how we would interconnect it to your existing electrical system. Or we can do what's called a supply side connection or a line side tap, where we go on the other side of your main breaker. But we can interconnect right to your electrical system without changing anything. Good question.
I have one more question to people.
Yeah. Oh, no, absolutely.
In the particular situation I'm looking at is a farm with three separate buildings, all that require electricity.
Yeah.
So is it practical to assume that you would put an array on the ground and run the electric to the three separate buildings, or do you put panels on all three buildings?
That's a great question. And actually, I realize that I didn't address it, but with current net metering rules, you can actually offset up to 9 accounts it's 10 accounts, not including the one where you interconnect the solar array, but you can offset 9 other accounts that you own. If you have the same name on that electric bill, you can install and interconnect the solar array at one of those buildings, and then but you can size the array to offset electricity use in that building as well as the two other buildings. And basically you would just build up credits that would be applied to those other accounts.